I was reading Isaiah chapter 6 about the vision of Isaiah for the last many, many days. Repeatedly I read, repeatedly I have gone through some old notes and some additions I made. So today I wanted to speak about that vision of Isaiah, which is seen in Isaiah chapter 6. But yesterday night, suddenly the vision of Moses in Exodus chapter 3 came to my mind. In the night I was reading and studying and prepared some notes. Morning when I just got up, suddenly the vision of Moses was before me. So again I opened my Bible and read those portions, and I am prompted by the Holy Spirit to speak about the vision of Moses today. And after one or two Sundays, God willing, we will study the vision of Isaiah. So today we will turn to Exodus chapter 3. Ragesh bhai can read from verse 2. Can you hear?
Yes, brother. Verse
1 to 14, we will read in 1 to chapter 3, verses 1 to 14.
Okay, brother. मूसा अपने ससुर यित्रो नामक मिद्यान के याजक की भेड़ बकरियों को चराता था और वह उन्हें जंगल के पश्चिमी ओर होरेब नामक पर्वत परमेश्वर के पर्वत के पास ले गया और परमेश्वर के दूत ने एक कटीली झाड़ी के बीच आग की लौ में उसको दर्शन दिया और उसने दृष्टि उठाकर देखा कि झाड़ी जल रही है पर भस्म नहीं होती। तब मूसा ने कहा, मैं उधर जाकर इस बड़े आश्चर्य को देखूंगा कि वह झाड़ी क्यों नहीं जल जाती। जब यहोवा ने देखा कि मूसा देखने में को मुड़ा चला आता है, तब परमेश्वर ने झाड़ी के बीच से उसको पुकारा, हे मूसा, हे मूसा। मूसा ने कहा, क्या आज्ञा? उसने कहा, इधर पास मत आ और अपने पांव से जूतियों को उतार दे, क्योंकि जिस स्थान पर तू खड़ा है वह पवित्र भूमि है। फिर उसने कहा, मैं तेरे पिता का परमेश्वर और अब्राहम का परमेश्वर, इसहाक का परमेश्वर और याकूब का परमेश्वर हूँ। तब मूसा ने, जो परमेश्वर की ओर देखने से डरता था, अपना मुंह ढांप लिया। फिर यहोवा ने कहा, मैंने अपनी प्रजा के लोग जो मिस्र में हैं, उनके दुख को निश्चय देखा है और उनकी जो चिल्लाहट परिश्रम करने वालों के कारण होती है उसको भी मैंने सुना है और उनकी पीड़ा पर मैंने चित्त लगाया है। इसलिए अब मैं उतर आया हूँ कि उन्हें मिस्रियों के वश से छुड़ाऊं और उस देश से निकालकर एक अच्छे और बड़े देश में, जिसमें दूध और मधु की धाराएं बहती हैं, अर्थात कनानी, हित्ती, एमोरी, परिज्जी, हिब्बी और यबूसी लोगों के स्थान में पहुंचाऊं। इसलिए अब सुन, इसराइलियों की चिल्लाहट मुझे सुनाई पड़ी है और मिस्रियों का उन पर अंधेर करना भी मुझे दिखाई पड़ा है। इसलिए आ, मैं तुझे फिरौन के पास भेजता हूँ कि तू मेरी इसराइली प्रजा को मिस्र से निकाल ले आए। परंतु मूसा ने परमेश्वर से कहा, मैं कौन हूँ जो फिरौन के पास जाऊं और इसराइलियों को मिस्र से निकाल ले आऊं? उसने कहा, निश्चय मैं तेरे संग रहूंगा और इस बात का कि तेरा भेजने वाला मैं हूँ, तेरे लिए यह चिन्ह होगा कि जब तू उन लोगों को मिस्र से निकाल चुके, तब तुम इसी पहाड़ पर परमेश्वर की उपासना करोगे। मूसा ने परमेश्वर से कहा, जब मैं इसराइलियों के पास जाकर उनसे कहूँ, तुम्हारे पितरों के परमेश्वर ने मुझे तुम्हारे पास भेजा है, तब यदि वे मुझसे पूछें उसका नाम क्या है, तब मैं उनको क्या बताऊं? परमेश्वर ने मूसा से कहा, मैं जो हूं सो हूं। फिर उसने कहा, तू इसराइलियों से यह कहना, जिसका नाम मैं हूं है, उसी ने मुझे तुम्हारे पास भेजा है।
ओके, थैंक यू। ये एक बहुत सुपरिचित भाग है। इधर 80 साल उम्र में ईश्वर का दर्शन मूसा को हुआ। ये दर्शन उसका जीवन को पूरा परिवर्तित किया। दिस विजन हैज कंप्लीटली ट्रांसफॉर्म्ड हिज लाइफ। इफ दिस विजन वाज नॉट देयर, मोसेस वुड हैव डाइड एज अ शेपर्ड। वी वुड नॉट हैव नोन एनीथिंग अबाउट दिस मैन। दिस विजन changed his life, transformed his life, and as a result, not only Israel was delivered, this man wrote the first 5 books of the Bible. Bible ka pehla 5 pustak inhi ke dwara humko mila hai. Abhi samajh lo, yadi ye 5 pustak humko nahi mila, what a great loss it would have been. The man who wrote the first 5 books of the Bible, he didn't know that after thousands of years, it will be translated into thousands of languages, and it will be read by millions and millions of people. He didn't know, but God knew. It's all because of this vision and his positive response to that vision and what God has asked him to do, though he was reluctant. So this portion of scripture is the secret of what Moses became in his life. So we are going to see 7 visions Moses had from this passage. First, he had verse 2. We read like this: and the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. The vision of the presence of God with his people, with his suffering people. This is the history of Israel in a nutshell. Israel ka itihas idhar samshipt roop mein hai. Itna dukh udaya hua log, bhoga hua log. The people who greatly suffered, unlike many other nations in the world, greatly suffered, and they have gone to foreign countries as slaves. They were taken, and AD 70 they were scattered once again until 1948. They became an independent nation. When Israel became independent and gathered there, there were and there are 80 language speaking people, and they did not know a word of Hebrew, their mother tongue, because of their continuous stay outside of Israel, that language also almost gone. But when the Israel returned, they decided to give importance to their mother tongue. What I want to say is this: they suffered like anything. Hundreds and thousands of people were killed by their enemies, and they suffered. But the remarkable thing here is God's presence with the suffering people. When people suffered, in that suffering also God was with them. In the 31st meeting, I just said about the presence of God, the possibility of the presence of God, the promise of the presence of God, the power of the presence of God, then the profitableness of the power of God, the presence of God. So God is with us. This is something we need to know. Whatever is our situation, we are not alone in this world. Good times, bad times, God is with us. We will read one verse, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 16. 2 Kings 6, 16.
उसने कहा, मत डर, क्योंकि जो हमारी ओर है वह उनसे अधिक है जो उनकी ओर है.
ओके, सो ही आंसर्ड, डू नॉट फियर, फॉर दोस हु आर विद अस आर मोर देन दोस हु आर विद देम. दिस इज एलिशा टॉकिंग टू द पीपल ऑफ गॉड. दे वर अफ्रेड by seeing the Assyrian army, and when they said to Elisha, he said, don't fear, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Now, the unseen companionship of the Lord and his angels. Here it is, not only God with us, his angels are there with us to guard us and protect us in this difficult world. So the first vision, God's presence with the suffering people. God is with his people. That is an inseparable union. We are not temporally related to God or connected to God. When we accepted Jesus Christ, we entered into a relationship which is inseparable. That's what we read in Romans chapter 8. What can separate us from the love of Christ? Nothing can separate us. None of these things. Paul is giving a big list towards the end of that chapter and saying, death or life or suffering or persecution, things present or things seen, unseen, nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. God is with his people. So the bush is burning, but it is not consumed. That is the history of Israel. They have gone through innumerable suffering, but they were did not destroyed. AD 70 onwards, they suffered. Nobody thought these people will survive. They will return to their homeland. But 1948 onwards, they are back in their homeland as a very prosperous nation on the earth. Okay, that is the first vision, vision of the presence of God with his people who are suffering, or with his people. That is very important. Secondly, God said to him, verse 5, do not draw near this place, take your sandals off your feet. The place where you stand is holy ground. Whenever we meet God, whether personally alone in our life or collectively like this, we need to remember God's presence and God is a holy God. We cannot come the way we like. We cannot talk, we cannot speak. When we come together, we have to be careful. We are sitting in the presence of God. And we are sitting on holy ground. God is with us. He is a holy God. God hates sin, whatever form it is. So we have to come by receiving the forgiveness of sin. That's very important. And this is not only every day a believer is receiving the cleansing. And as a sinner, a man has come to God, reconciled to God, confessed his sin, and received the forgiveness of God, the cleansing of God. He became a righteous, holy person. And continuously receiving cleansing in this life. So first one is permanent one. Second, continuously we have to go through this. So this was a vision about the holiness of God. Why these people have suffered? Because they forgot the holiness of God. They thought they can live the way they like. After doing anything and everything, they can come and worship God. God said, no, I don't want this. I hate your worship. I hate your sacrifice. I don't want. Learn to live in holiness. This is very important for us. And as people of God, this is a big challenge for us. How to live a holy life in this unholy world? How to be right in an all wrong world? How to be pure in an impure world? How can we be straight in a crooked world? That is our challenge. So God says that you are sitting on holy ground. You are standing on holy ground. Every time when we come near to God for prayer or reading of the Holy Word or assembling together to worship God, and we should remind ourselves, God is with us and God is watching us. God demands holiness, and we know what God has demanded from his people: be holy as I am holy. It is not like some other leaders. God did not say, you be holy like your great leaders. No. Be holy as I am holy. God is our standard. So the second one is vision about the holiness of God. I believe that this is something we need today in this world, in the Christendom. People should come back to the holiness and holy life. That's very important. Third, verse 6. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. So here, vision about the relationship of God and his people. It is not something God is going to start. First time, God tells Moses that I have started a relationship with your forefathers many, many generations before. I am the same God. Relationship with God. Now, some of us are first generation believers. about us, God cannot say like that. But after our life, let our children and our grandchildren look back to us and say, this God is the God of my grandfather, God of my father. And God will say one day to such children, I am the God of your father. I am the God of your grandfather. So relationship, if they belong to God, only God can say that. So God is saying to Moses, you understand my relationship with your people, the nation of Israel, the children of God. Long back, what started with Abraham, it is continuing. And you are my people, I am yours. So that is the third thing God says. Vision about a relationship and fellowship of God's people with their God. Then come down to verse 8. So I have come down to deliver them out of the land of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. So here is the vision about the promised land. And God says, I want to deliver my people and take them to the promised land. That is Canaan. And here is the vision about the promised land. Of course, Canaan is not the picture of heaven. It is about the victorious life. But here is a lesson. We should have a vision about our eternal abode, where we are going to be. If death separates us from this world today, if Jesus returns today, where we are going, where we will be, that we need to remember always. As Philippians chapter 3 verse 20, Paul reminds the Philippians, telling them, our citizenship is in heaven. Jesus promised that I am going to prepare a place for you. When I prepare that place, I will come again and receive you unto myself. All these generations, the true believers expected that. They thought that, you know, in their generation, Jesus will return. That did not happen. We do not know in our generation, Jesus is returning or not. If it happens, it is fine, praise God. Otherwise, it may take some more time. But one thing is sure, this promise is going to be fulfilled. Jesus is returning. And a place is being prepared for us. We should have the vision about that place, the superiority of that place, the permanency of that place. We need to understand. These are all going to be temporary. I remind myself frequently, this is only for a short time we need. We have to leave all these things and go from here to a place which is being prepared for us. If death comes, we read about Lazarus, that poor man who died. In Luke's Gospel chapter 16, the angels of God came, took him to Abraham's bosom. Paul said, absent from the body and present with the Lord. And this world is not my home. I am just passing through. I am a citizen of heaven. I belong to heaven. So we should have that vision of our promised land. Our promised land is not Palestine where Israel is living today, which is occupied by them. That is not. And we are going to that heavenly Jerusalem, which is being prepared by the Lord Jesus Christ, promised for us. So we should have that vision of that place, the promised land. Then we come down to the next vision, verse 10. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Verse 8 also, so I have come down to deliver them. Here we read about God's program. God has come down. God says, I heard the cry. Verse 7. I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. I have come down to deliver them. Then tells Moses 10, verse 10, come now, therefore, I'll send you to Pharaoh, so that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. So here, in the vision about the program of God. God has a program. And every child of God, every servant of God should ask and should know very well what is the program of God. What is God doing in this world in the present time? He's preparing a people. He is saving people, gathering them together, which is called the Church of Jesus Christ. And he is building his church. Jesus said, I will build my church. And however great a man is, he is only a laborer, a helper with the Lord. Whenever there is some construction work, we see the mason, and he will have one or two helpers. And he will just order from the workplace, bring the bricks, bring the cement, bring the sand, bring the water. He just orders and things are brought according to his command. That's all the work of God is. God is the chief worker. God has a work. God says, Jesus says, I will build my church. And he is building his church. And we do not know when it is going to be completed. It is not a time-bound program. It is a number-related program. When that exact number gets completed, Jesus will come back. That we have to remind ourselves. Why Jesus is delaying his coming? The only reason that number is not completed yet. If that number completes today, Jesus will come back. So God has a program. And today, the sad thing, people, those who are in the work of God, they will make a program. They will have their own programs. I used to hear earlier, people are making big programs. By 2000, we are going to have a church in every village of India. And people who said that, they are not in the world today. That did not happen. And they never bothered whether it is the program of God or not. Who are you to say that? Nobody has the right to make their own programs. We should be simply available to the Lord. That is all what God wants. So God has given the vision about God's program, God's plan, what I am going to do hereafter, how I need you, how I need your cooperation, how you have to associate with me. That is what God said. So about the work of God, we all have a part to play. And we are also part of that building his church. If Jesus says to us, go and give this Bible to a person, just simply do that. And share the gospel with a person, do that. So let us get involved in the program of God. So as we get involved, and when more people get saved, when that number is completed, Jesus will come back. And again, I just want to repeat, this is not a time-bound program. Jesus did not say that 2000 AD, I will come back. No. And people thought and predicted like that. There are many date fixers. People who try to fix dates. It is not allowed. As I said, it is not related to time. It is related to number. That believers have to understand. Then sixthly, 7 to 10, we read about God's people. Verse 7, God says, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know that their sorrow. So I have come down to deliver them from the hands of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Verse 10 we read, 9 we read, now therefore behold the cry of the children of Israel. Then verse 10, come now therefore and I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people. It was a vision about the people of God. We need to know who are the people of God. Today, God's people are those who belong to his church. Who belongs to the church? I am not talking about the Brethren Church or CNI or CSI or Marthoma or Orthodox or Methodist or Baptist or you name it. I am not talking about that, those churches. I am talking about the real church, which the Lord Jesus is building. He said, I will build my church. And a person can become part of that church only through the Lord Jesus Christ. If Jesus does not save that person and accept that person, he cannot be part of that church. How can a person become part of that church? He has to hear the gospel. He has to understand the gospel. And he has to confess his sin and believe the gospel. See, knowing Christ and receiving Christ are two different things. Now, our children who are brought up in good spiritual atmosphere, they have the repeated opportunity to hear the word of God. right from childhood. That is fine. And that from childhood they are knowing Christ. But receiving is something different. On the basis of your knowledge, how you responded to Christ, you received him or not received him. Receiving Christ is not that easy. The moment you receive Christ, he not only becomes your savior, he becomes your Lord. He will exercise lordship in your life. So you surrender completely. It's just like a man who joins in the army, military. The moment he becomes part of that army, he is being controlled by the army. He cannot have his own choices, his own decisions. Every single decision for him is made by them. Where to stay, what to eat, what time you have to get up, what is your work, everything is decided by them. And that is Christian life. No, to many people, Christian life is, they think that, you know, I have raised my hand in a meeting. I am baptized. And I want to repeat this once again. Many, many thousands of baptized people will be in hell. But there will be many unbaptized people in heaven. Baptism will not take anybody to heaven. Christian religion cannot save anybody. Christian church cannot save anybody, including my church, which I am part of. This church is not going to save. Christian home cannot save. Christian parents cannot save. Christian baptism cannot save. If you want to be saved, you have to come to Jesus Christ. He alone can save you. He alone can forgive your sins. None of the other things can save you. It's all fooling people. People changing their church, you know, joining from one religion to another religion. This religion is of no use. This Christian religion cannot save anybody. Christian church cannot save anybody. Christian parents cannot save anybody. Christian home cannot save anybody. Christian baptism cannot save. Whether it is infant baptism or adult baptism, it cannot save. Only when you repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, he saves, he saves. And you get into a direct relationship with the Lord. So this is very important. We need to know who are the people of God, who is not the people of God. Now that's why when I meet new people, I'll ask them some questions. One question is, say something about your Christian experience. When they speak that, I can make out. Or sometimes I'll ask in a different way, how did he come to know the Lord Jesus? So, the answer which I get will give me a picture where exactly they stand. So, we need to know who is a child of God, who is not a child of God. Why we need to know? If he is not a child of God, we will tell him how to become a child of God. If he is a child of God, we encourage him to live as a child of God in this world. That's why we need to know. So it is very important. You know, sometimes people may think that, you know, this will bring little uncomfortableness to people. And they may get offended. Why should we ask? You know, don't ask such kind of questions. If you do like that, You are going to do a big disservice to those people. They will end up in hell after attending your church, after attending your Bible studies, because you never asked them about their spiritual stand. This is very important. So anyone who is listening to me today, please ask yourself whether John 1:12 happened in your life or not. John 3:16 happened in your life or not. What is John 1:12? As many as received him, that is Jesus, to them God gave the power to become the children of God. Now this happens in every marriage. What happens? A girl who is brought up in another home becomes part of her husband's home. She leaves her parents and relatives and coming to a new place, into a new home, a new relationship. So John 1:12 says, as many as received him, to them God gave the power to become the children of God. We are all born as children of God. There is no need to become. So we are not children of God. Adam's children means the entire human being. They lost the right to be the children of God. But Jesus has come to make us the children of God. And only the children of God can enter into heaven. I used to give this example in Ahmedabad, because there it is, you know, more crowded people are. Generally, you know, the school bus comes. Lot of children will get down from the school bus or a school rickshaw. And my children will come to my home. And the neighbor's children will go to their home. And you will see that in the opposite side of the street, children who are part of those families, they will go to their own homes. If you are not a child of God, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. One day everything will be over. And today you have to make sure, doubly sure, that you are a child of God. You belong to God. That's very important. I accepted Jesus as my Savior according to John chapter 1 verse 12. And I am a child of God. John 3:60, as many as received, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So vision about the people of God, that's very important. Don't think that this NDR Christian religion and people who are part of this religion, they will enter into the kingdom of God. No, it is not. You know, somebody said when we reach heaven, there will be many, many surprising things. One is that people who were expected to be there, you expected these people because they are such a good people. They are not there. That is one surprise. Another surprise. People who are not expected by you, they are there. And probably they did not say about their faith. They lived a little secretly due to various reasons. So suddenly you have seen them there, and it will be a big surprise. But Moses said to God, "Who am I?" This was a vision about himself. Now, 40 years before, Moses so thought, "I am somebody, and I can do it." After 40 years, he says, "I am nobody, I cannot do that." It was a vision about himself. When he talked to God, when God talked to him, he understood his insignificance, his inadequacies, his limitations. Rest of the verses are talking about that, his inadequacies. He said, "I am not the right person," ultimately he said. "There are other qualified people than me." For example, his own brother Aaron. So he started making excuses. He found that he is not qualified to do that. That is another important thing for anyone who is preaching, teaching. The moment he thinks that I can do it, then it is going to be a big failure. Instead of that, if we say like Apostle Paul, "I am what I am by the grace of God, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me," then he will be used by the Lord. So a vision about ourselves, humanly speaking, this is something, this ministry of God is a very difficult job. But when God enables, God helps, will be equipped and enabled and qualified to do it. So that is what happened. God said to Moses, "I am going to be with you. I'll help you. I'll be with your mouth. You are not going to do it alone. And I'll be available to you. My power, my help, my presence, my blessing will be there." Yes, as servants of God, as people who are involved in the work of God, we need to recognize our own limitations. But as Paul said, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." May it be so. So this vision of Moses completely changed him, made him a new man. And because of this vision, he not only delivered Israel and guided them, led them 40 long years, instructed them, taught them. And from that time onwards, because of these 5 books, which is written by this man, after this encounter with God, the world is blessed. And today also, we are being blessed by these 5 books, which is written by this great man of God. May his name be glorified.